Hello, firearms friends. Joel Colander here again for Rock Island Auction Company. For items, showing you items that are coming up for sale on day three of our June 10th, 11th, 12th Sporting Collector Firearms Auction. Of course, if you're watching this when it comes out, you're currently watching during day two, and we're going to show you something coming up the next day that you could possibly bid on because, frankly, there's amazing items on all 3 days. In case you couldn't tell, today we're going to look at a few protectors, a few palm squeezers, palm pistols. They go by a couple different names. And we're going to look at several variations that we have on the sale. Now, I cheated a little bit. These three I took from day two. These three are actually on day three. So, but if you're lucky, these are far enough in day two, you may still be able to place bids on them. So no blood, no foul, right? I will say before I dive into this that there isn't, to my knowledge, a definitive resource for the information on these palm protector pistols. There's a lot of regurgitated information over the internet. There are some very reliable sources who say things different than that. There are even old books like Firearms Curiosa, which cite some different information. So calibers are very, some are cited as 5.6 millimeter. Is that rounded up to 6 millimeter in other sources? Does that explain a discrepancy? Who knows? I think a book on, or at least they are small, maybe a pamphlet. On these things and their evolutions would be welcomed by someone who can investigate some firsthand sources. But that aside, let's look into what we know for sure. Paris, France, 1882. And they are marked Paris on here. Le Protecteur by Jacques Turbiaux. Again, this is 1882. So nothing new under the sun. Even late 19th century, people looking for small concealable firearms for self-protection. Of course, it predates that too. But that aside, he designed it to be sort of no bigger than a pocket watch, and you can see he's largely succeeded in that. And he didn't want any part of it really to be exposed when holding it in the hand, so I'd say he succeeded at that as well. Most of these you'll find throughout the variations are nickel-plated, and quite wisely, he did anticipate there to be close contact with the body, so anything to sort of help preserve the finish and preserve the firearm when being in close contact was welcomed. These came in two variations, so there's a 22 center fire version, which was 10 shots, and then the other caliber, depending on what size, what research source you have, is like an 8 millimeter, 7-shot version. This is the smaller 10-shot. So from the outside, of course, being smaller than some of the other variations, there is a sliding safety on top that later American versions don't have. However, the internals remain remarkably similar, so let's take a look at that right now. This actually just give a slight quarter turn, and there are some interrupted threads in there that just allow you to kind of slide it in and lock it into place. And here we have our rotary magazine, not rotary like you think of with a Krag or a Johnson, but with an actual almost wagon wheel of rounds. And you'd load them actually from the inside, so they're pointing out. The rims of those sit nicely in there. And on the inside, this is the best part, the mechanism is so simple. So when you squeeze this, you see we have this sort of top arm that pushes in, and it is serving essentially as the what we would consider a hand on a modern revolver. It's pushing these cylinder stops here on what I guess would be considered our radial cylinder. That's probably a little more accurate than a rotary. And it's moving those, and so it's a double action. It's cocking it at the same time. You can see with this bottom hand. The bottom hand is pushing. It's pushing against a sear. This actually, this sort of eyeball teardrop shaped in the middle is actually has our firing pin on it. And when it gets back to a certain distance, the snaps forward to the sear and fires the round. And that's all there is to it. There's a couple springs, a couple pieces of metal. It's really, really quite simple. And one would think, therefore, easy to produce, which helped it to be carried into the United States. So after production begins in Paris, we move to America. So in 1882, we said he patents in Paris. 1883, Turbiaux patents his system in America, and they begin being made by the Minneapolis Firearms Company. And here's where things get a little muddy, to say the least. There aren't very many produced by the Minneapolis Firearm Company. Some sources say as little as 3,000 between that 1883 and what would eventually be like 1892. Why so few? I'm not really sure. That's not documented. It's also, some sources say that it would have been produced under Turbiaux's patent. Some say the patent at that point was bought by an American, a Peter Finnegan, I believe, who would have purchased the patent. Some sources say he didn't purchase that until 1892 when he formed the Chicago Firearms Company and started having them produced. So things are a little muddy, a little unclear around the Minneapolis arms. So I hate to quote any, you know, only 3,000 produced, but we do know when they existed. In 1883, they were patent holders. So in the Minneapolis, just to show you how conflicting sources are, there are some sources that say, you know, the Minneapolis doesn't have a safety. And they're saying that because it doesn't have like the sliding safety that we saw on the Parisian version. And it doesn't have the sort of trigger safety, if you will, that the Chicago version does. But it does. The Minneapolis definitely has a safety. And it's this little rotating wheel back here. What it does is it has a small hole here on my right, your left side. And our transfer bar has this little lug or notch on it. And when the safety is off, that lug is allowed to pass through and you can compress the trigger completely and fire it. And, but when you give it a quick turn, that lug stops and you can't squeeze it enough to rotate the cylinder, to index the cylinder or to fire the pistol. So there is a safety on the Minneapolis. It's just quite a departure from either of the other two versions. So in 1892 is where things start to come to a head because Finnegan, who had purchased the patents, again, some say in 1883, some say in 1892, was preparing to make a whole bunch of his Chicago version for the Chicago World's Fair, the Columbian Exposition in that year. He wanted 15,000 of them made so he could offer them at the World's Fair to the millions and millions of people that would be attending over the months. Now, most sources say that Finnegan didn't have any manufacturing capability and that he had to hire out the production to Ames Sword Company. Now, if you've watched our auctions, you know Ames for their beautiful, beautiful dress swords or presentation swords. If you're more of a military collector for the fighting style, you know obviously they had quite a hand in some bayonets later on. But that's a kind of a discrepancy in the story. If he didn't have production and had to turn to Ames, who was producing them if he did indeed have the patent for Minneapolis? Who was making those productions? So to me, it doesn't make sense. It's one of the little discrepancies. But what we do know for sure is that they butted heads because Ames was only able to produce out of the order of 15,000. They were only able to produce about 1,500 by the time that Finnegan wanted them. So Finnegan sued. Here's more historical discrepancies occur. It's said that Ames countersued. Some sources say they settled. Some sources say that Finnegan just won outright. But at the end of the day, Ames was still producing these throughout the lawsuit. And when it was all said and done, when the dust had settled, there were 12,800, I believe, again, sources vary, of the Chicago palm pistols as produced by Ames Sword Company. So eventually, of course, Ames was, they're selling them off and eventually kind of lost interest or had to abandon them in 1910. Remington oddly produced the ammunition through 1920 for what that's worth. And that's basically the history of these things. But let's get into some of the fun, some of the neat little ways that they were able to produce these. You'll notice most of these in nickel finish. There are those that are not in nickel finish. They are rare birds. There are those that are engraved, and we like to see those as well. Most times you'll find these rubber or gutta-percha grips. You'll see them in 10-shot. You'll see them in different calibers. This, the Parisian version, has a little coin purse carry. So, you know, because any bandit or ne'er-do-well or mugger would give you plenty of time to open your coin purse-style holster, remove your pistol, and then conceal it in your fist to shoot them. I'm sure there's a France joke in there, but we're going to leave it alone. Next, over chronologically to the Minneapolis, again, presumably produced for a very short time. We have a sort of a standard version up here. Here we have a standard version as well, but it comes with a bookcase, The Science, La Science. Not French like Le Science. Maybe I don't speak French. But the first several pages are in French before being hollowed out for a nice little concealable pistol, even in the home. So they were thinking of all sorts of uses for these protector pistols. And here we have a horse of a different color, one of the Chicago versions, of course, with the pearl inset away from the gutta percha. We have some really nice sort of markings around the side. And one thing I didn't mention when discussing them chronologically, so we had a sliding safety on the French version, but the Chicago produced ones have this little notch up there. So when that is depressed, you can squeeze the pistol, and when it's not, you cannot squeeze the pistol. It cannot be fired. So you really have to be grabbing around the barrel as such. This one also, I should mention, this is a reproduction case, but it has this, I included it because it has this great reproduction of one of the actual labels for the protector inside. If you want to view a little bit closer up, go check it out on the website. Last but not least, when we're talking about the 32XF or the 32 extra short rimfire, that's what one of those cartridges looks like. It's just over half the length of the last segment on my pinky finger. Like, I don't know how else to show you how ridiculously small these are. But if it goes bang, it's likely to scare away a bad guy. And frankly, it probably didn't feel like a massage. So they would have been effective in some measure. I hope you guys liked looking at some of the Protector Palm pistols, hearing about the evolution and some of the different versions, cased, ammo, pearl, gutta percha, nickel, little coin purses, you name it. They're kind of a fun facet of collecting and a very unusual firearm, of course, to say the least. So hopefully you head over to rockislandauction.com. Check out day 3 of our June 10th through 12th Sporting Collector Firearms Auction. You can bid on these. You can come in person or you can bid live on REAC Live. Thanks for watching, everybody. Till next time, keep that powder dry.